A very good morning and welcome to the second joint meeting in 2022 of members of the Criminal Justice, the Health, Social Care and Sport and the Social Justice and Social Security Committees to consider the progress being made in implementing the recommendations of the Scottish Drug Deaths Task Force. There are no apologies this morning, and can I ask members to ensure that their mobile phones are switched to silent and wait for the sound engineer to switch your microphone on before speaking. Our first item this morning is to decide whether to take item 3 in private, which is consideration of the evidence heard. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much indeed. Our next item is our second evidence session on reducing drugs deaths in Scotland and tackling problem drug use, and I refer members Papers 1 and 2. And I welcome to the meeting Mr. David Strang, Chair of the Scottish Drugs Deaths Task Force. And I thank Mr. Strang for his written submission, and I invite him to make some brief opening remarks. Mr. Strang, if I can ask you to speak for around 3 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, convener and members. Thank you for inviting me to this session and for the opportunity to make a few opening remarks. 3 weeks ago today, I was appointed to chair the task force, though I am new in this post. But the task force itself, of course, is not new. It's been going for over 2.5 years and has achieved a great deal in that time. Scotland's drug-related deaths have rightly been described as a public health crisis or emergency. Every premature death as a result of drug use is a tragedy, tragedy for individuals, for families and for communities. And they demonstrate an urgent need to improve how we respond to this crisis. And we need to change what we are doing. The task force role is to examine the evidence and to make recommendations. Recommendations that will lead to reducing the number of people dying from drugs and to improve the health of people who use drugs. The task force has already achieved some major milestones. The availability and use of naloxone as an emergency response to save lives. It's made recommendations on drug law reform. It has developed the new medication-assisted treatment, the MAT standards, and it's published a strategy to tackle stigma that is associated with drug use. But there remains a great deal of work to be done to address the challenges that Scotland faces. Now, these challenges are not just for the task force, not just for health services and the criminal justice system, but these challenges are for all of Scotland, whether it's government at national and local level, partner organisations, businesses, third sector and communities themselves. The new vice chair of the task force, Fiona McQueen, and I look forward to working with the task force members to continue this important work for the next 6 months. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, David. If I can maybe just start off questions, I'd like to just ask you a very general question. You mentioned there that you were appointed chair just a matter of weeks ago. I think you said 3 weeks ago. And you outlined the role of the task force in terms of gathering evidence and making recommendations and milestones that the task force was seeking to achieve. I'm just interested to hear your early views on particularly the remit in terms of reference of the task force. Do you feel that they're currently fit for purpose? Is the focus of the task force the right one? And perhaps a little bit about the timescales for delivery that have been set by the Scottish Government, if you feel that these are achievable. So a bit of a roll-up, but interested to hear your early views.
Yes, thank you. So it was 3 weeks ago today I was appointed, and I chaired my first meeting of the task force the following Wednesday, so a fortnight ago, and that was the 19th meeting of the task force itself. I mean, the task force has been on a bit of a journey. It was launched in the summer of 2019 after the publication of the 2018 drug deaths, and it was to run for the length of the Parliament. So its anticipated end date was in May last year, but was extended, as you know, following the election to continue its work. I mean, it's a matter of judgment, really, how much you include in a task force such as this in its remit, because, and I'm sure we'll get on to discuss it this morning, this is, while the focus is on drugs, the topic itself is much, much wider than that. And I mentioned already that it's not just an issue for health services and the police and the criminal justice system, but for much wider support and all arms of government, national and local. But I think it is reasonable that it's got a clear focus on particularly, I suppose, because it's about reducing drug deaths, it's looking at people who are using drugs and in a serious way, and trying to stop them on a pathway to death. So the focus is inevitably on things like emergency response, support and treatment for people who are using, and trying to be effective in meeting their needs and supporting them. Now, there's a whole other agenda about prevention. How do we stop people going down that track? Now, I have views on that. I'm sure the task force does, but that's not the main focus. Our focus is on reducing drug deaths, so concentrating at that high end. And you asked me, Kavina, about the timescale. We have a work plan, and we will be producing as our final product in the summer of this year a roadmap which will lay out what needs to happen over the next 5 years or so. Because of course the problem won't be solved, you wouldn't expect me to say this, in 6 months or in 12 months. I mean, we're talking about major cultural change in Scotland. And we're talking about reshaping services to support the needs of people who are using drugs, and changing what we have been doing. So the work, of course, will continue. But in terms of the remit of the task force, we will complete that, make our recommendations. But the work and the recommendation implementation clearly will go beyond the life of the task force.
Thanks very much. That's a helpful sort of overview. Can I just ask a very quick follow-up question in terms of where you feel the task force currently sits in terms of delivering on the tasks that it has been set? I'd be interested to hear a little bit about your views on where you feel the task force currently is on that.
I'm really interested in what happens next. So, I mean, I've been looking through the reports of the task force over the last 2.5 years. There are over 100 recommendations, and that is the role of the task force. So we are looking at evidence, making recommendations. So it's not our responsibility to implement them or to review and so on. But of course, I, as the incoming chair, am really interested in what has happened to those recommendations. Have they made a difference? Because some of them were made as early as April 2020, so nearly 2 years ago, and I would have expected to have seen some change as a result of that. Now, that's a question I'll be asking. I don't know the answer to that, but I would hope that things have changed and that the recommendations of the task force will have led to improvements. I mean, if they haven't, then I suppose that will be something that we will comment on as we get to the final report and the roadmap, to say, well, if we've made recommendations, how well have they been implemented? So implementation is for others, and I think continuing beyond that, there needs to be some sort of scrutiny and oversight to encourage implementation of the recommendations.
Thanks very much. Thank you for that. I'm just going to open up now to members, and I'm going to bring in Paul O'Kane, and then after Paul, I'll bring in Russell Finlay. So, Paul.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to David, and welcome to the role. We appreciate that it's a fairly new role for yourself. I wonder if I could just perhaps follow on from the convener's last question there, just in terms of, I think, that delivery of the recommendation of the task force and scrutiny of whether that's being delivered or not. I think it's fair to say that there's been criticism from some people that the task force has seen itself as an advisory body only. But is it your feeling that it should have more power in terms of pressing stakeholders on delivery? Or indeed, you referred to the kind of scrutiny of that delivery and, you know, looking at whether things have been implemented or not. I mean, is your view that there needs to be more power for the task force to follow up?
No, I don't think there needs to be more power for the task force because I mean, in terms of delivering change, that has to be by existing institutions, organisations and structures. So we are giving advice, we're making recommendations, we are advisory. Now, clearly, I imagine the government wouldn't have set up a task force and, you know, with a view to not listening to its advice and taking it on board. After the election, the task force entered phase two. The first phase, I think they were more sort of operational. They were funding projects and making decisions about research and so on, commissioning work. I think in this second phase, we are more looking at those projects and the results of the research and making recommendations. I know that the government team supporting the task force and the whole drugs policy has increased and has a more active role in implementing policy. I know that some of the projects that the task force has kicked off will continue into next year, into 2023. So that's what I meant about there needs to be a mechanism for still continuing to gather the learning from the projects that have been started and make sure that those are implemented. I'm not arguing that the task force should have more power nor should extend, but I'm just saying that one of the questions I'll be asking is, well, who is now, how is that going to be overseen, whether it's by a different scrutiny body or a role for the government itself?
Thank you, convener. If I can, just as a follow-up, you know, I think this is the first time we've come together as committees on these issues, and I think this is a very helpful forum. We are very keen, obviously, that Parliament has a strong role in terms of the scrutiny and delivery of the Minister and the national mission, and obviously the Minister will be here after you. But do you feel that you know, scrutiny by Scottish Parliament committees and perhaps this sort of forum is one of the avenues we could take in terms of analysing those recommendations and tracking their implementation?
Yes, definitely. I'd be delighted if the Parliament took an active role in following up on the recommendation of the task force and seeking reports from government and others on what's been implemented and, perhaps more importantly, what's been the impact of that. Have services increased? Are drug users getting better treatment and care? What has been the impact of implementing the recommendations? So I would welcome that role that you're suggesting.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Paul. I'll now bring in Russell Finlay, followed by Gillian Martin. So over to you, Russell.
Thank you. Hello, Mr. Strang. Your predecessor, Professor Katrina Matheson, and her deputy, Neil Richardson, both quit, saying that the Scottish Government's strategy was actually counterproductive. Have you had any contact with either of them? Have you evaluated their concerns? And if so, what are your views on them, please?
I don't think I really want to comment on the views of my predecessor. To answer your specific question, yes, absolutely. I've had a very good conversation with Katrina Matheson. We've talked about the work of the task force to date and what remains to be done. So I find that really helpful conversation. I've talked a little bit in my answer to the convener's question about timescale. You know, I think it is a matter of judgment. We will have been going 3 years now, whether where the government gets its advice from. Clearly, we're not the only source of advice. There are other experts in the field. There's academic drug network and so on. So we have a specific task to do, and we will do that and complete that by July. That will be the work of the task force, but clearly the work of tackling Scotland's drug problems go on and has to be addressed by a whole wide range of organisations and official bodies. So it won't stop with the finishing of this task force work.
The Drugs Desk Task Force has recommended the introduction of so-called tolerance zones. Now, we heard that Police Scotland have concerns about these. What is your personal view? Do you support the task force recommendation?
Well, the task force is recommending that those be considered and examined. And I think with a number of the recommendations, there have been quite radical new thinking, and I really welcome that. Now, they haven't gone into the detail of exactly what that would look like, but in terms of, it's linking with safer consumption facilities. The strength of responding to drugs is to make sure that everyone understands what's being done and why it's being done. And the right to raise that whole issue about policing style and policing activities. To what extent does that support what is being done with, say, drug consumption facilities, or would it be counterproductive? Now, clearly, if you had a very heavy presence of the police who were searching everyone coming near, then that would be counterproductive, and what would be the point of it? So I think I have to say that Police Scotland are very involved in the task force. I know you've had evidence from ACC Assistant Chief Constable Gary Ritchie. And in that evidence, he is very supportive of the public health approach to responding to Scotland's drug crisis. So I'm confident that they will be very supportive of what we're doing and recommending.
Thank you. And very quickly, it does seem that tolerance zones would be around about any drug consumption facilities. Scotland have also expressed concern about them and the practicalities of these. Can you expand on what these might look like, how many there would be, where they would be?
Sorry, Mr. Quinton, were you asking about the drug consumption facilities, the safer drugs?
The proposed drug consumption facilities, can you expand on how many of these would be needed, where they might be, that kind of detail?
No, I don't think we've gone into that detail. I mean, this is a radical proposal, and I have to say that in my briefing form and discussions with the minister last month, she encouraged the task force to be radical and to push the boundaries of ideas. So I think if you were to go down the road of safer consumption, that would need to be a matter for local communities. I mean, it would be agreed in principle and clearly all the legalities practicalities would need to be worked out at a national level. But I think it would be an issue that local authorities, local health boards, local police would have a view on, and they're the ones who do decide rather than the task force saying exactly how many and where they should be.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Russell. I'm now going to bring in Gillian Martin, followed by Pauline McNeill. Gillian.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Mr. Strang, to your role. The task force, as you said, have put together many recommendations, and they have been based on a huge amount of evidence and research that's been commissioned by the task force. As a result of that research and that work, do we have a clearer understanding of why we have got this particular Scottish crisis in terms of drugs death?
I think what we know is that there's no simple answer to your question. I mean, it's a good question, as people ask, why does Scotland have, you know, 3.5 times the UK number of deaths? So last year, the last year for which we have figures, which is 2020, 1,339 people died drug-related deaths, which is over three a day. So more than three people every day in Scotland are dying from drugs, which you know, is an absolutely shocking and scandalous number. And that is the highest ever. And for the last 6 years, the numbers have been increasing year on year. And in that last year, 78 young people under the age of 25 died from drug-related deaths. So it is a crisis. But the answer to why is that the case is it'll be contested. There'll be people with different views. It's been a long-standing challenge for Scotland, and we know what the factors are that contribute, and these are well known, that there'll be include things like poverty and inequality, early abuse and trauma. It'll be to do with mental health, and then there are a lot of common factors such as offending, homelessness, relationship breakdown, loneliness, violence. All of these things are associated and are linked. And so it's saying that there's not a single answer to, well, we could say exactly why Scotland has such a high problem. It also means that there's no simple solution. And we just say, oh, if we just did that one thing, that would solve it. So it has to be, you know, in understanding what the underlying causes and factors are, we need to have a broad response that addresses each of those as well.
Thank you. And I wonder, I mean, it's very complicated. It's very complex, as you've just stated. Are we really at the point where we have to now be trying myriad interventions, as you said in previous answers to my colleagues, that some of them were quite radical? And I mean, is there a learning from elsewhere, where, you know, other countries or other indeed cities that have had particular problems with drugs deaths, where things have been tried that are yielding results that we need to look at?
I was going to say that's a good question, but it's a good question because I've asked it of the team. I've said, well, where can we learn from elsewhere? So that is a question I'm asking, and undoubtedly we can learn from elsewhere. And I know that the task force has done some work on international comparators. I think you know, your question about is it therefore needing multiple response? Yes, it will do. I think the most significant shift in response that I've seen in recent years has been no longer seeing drugs as simply a crime and justice issue, but now seeing it as a health issue. And I mean, in my opening comments, I was just repeating the words I've held elsewhere, but this is a public health crisis, and that's not over the Parliament, but certainly the government's position. And I agree completely with that. You know, I was in the police myself, and you know, 40 years ago, it was thought that the solution to drug use was more law enforcement. It was about crime and punishment, and I think we have a much greater understanding that this, you know, crime, dealing with it as crime and punishing people, is, well, we've been trying it for 40 or 50 years, it clearly hasn't worked. But I think even not just that sort of statement, but an understanding that it is a health issue. Addiction is a health issue that you will not solve by punishing people, but they need care, they need treatment, they need support. Now, clearly, there is a role for the police, and I'm talking about ancillary crimes. So, you know, if there's violence associated or acquisitive crime, theft, and clearly drug trafficking. But in terms of the very heart of people who are dying, because it's not the criminals who are dying, it's the people who are suffering addiction. And therefore, the solution needs a change of attitude to seeing drug problems as a health issue and not a crime issue.
Thank you very much. Convener, back to you.
Thank you very much, Julian. I'm now going to bring in Pauline McNeill, followed by Miles Briggs. Over to you, Pauline.
Good morning, and thanks for the work that you are doing. I wanted to ask you this question about a continuation of the law reform issue in terms of review of the 71 Act with the possibility of creating safe consumption rooms to prevent deaths. I mean, I note that you said earlier that it's important to explain to people what we're doing in any reform. But I hosted in 2018 Nanna Godfredsen, a street lawyer from Denmark, who led the charge in the Danish Parliament to change policy and safe consumption rooms. And she's very much behind what's going on, I think, in Glasgow. But having researched it, I mean, there are 66 cities where apparently there's been no death and no evidence that it has increased drug use. So my first question is, do you think it's important to have credible evidence on this so we can decide whether it is evidence that we can use or not to make a judgment on whether this is one of the tools that we could use to stop deaths?
Thank you for that question. I mean, the task force has recommended safer drug consumption, so it has been satisfied. I mean, obviously not in my time, but the you know, they were satisfied that there is sufficient credible evidence, and so that is the recommendation, and I agree with that recommendation. And I think your wider point about if we're going to try and change public opinion and political views and get political buy-in, then I do think that credible evidence is really important, and that's at the heart of what the task force has been doing, is looking at that evidence and using it. But of course, you know, I've given evidence to committee of the parliament before, and you hear people say, well, that might be the evidence, but I don't believe that. I think it's still right to lock people, you know, so people aren't necessarily persuaded by the evidence. And I suppose I was just struck by lots of the emergency implementation or changes that had to be made because of COVID. I mean, there was no evidence of what the impact of the vaccine for 5 years is, because it just wasn't available, but they went ahead and did what had to be done. So I'm not in any way minimizing the need for evidence, because I absolutely believe that evidence is very helpful. But we have lots of evidence for the recommendations that the task force have been making. And so I suppose I'm slightly reluctant to agree that we need more evidence, because I think the evidence is overwhelming for supporting drug consumption rooms.
Very much. Yesterday, we heard from the Minister, Kit Malthouse, and we had an exchange, a number of us, on the same subject. And what he had to say was, it's very complex. So, as you know, our Lord Advocate may consider this question, and she's already consulting with the police and so on. And Kit Mulhouse said, well, what if we set up an overdose prevention site in Govan? Would you arrest someone who was travelling to Govan from Edinburgh? Now, I think it's actually quite a simple answer to that. I mean, obviously, you've been a former chief constable, so you've seen us. I mean, in Glasgow, we had tolerance zones for what was then called street prostitution. So it's quite clear. It's not as complex in my mind. If you set up a zone which you would disapply the law, so anyone outside that zone would be breaking the law in order to make sure that we direct people to the. I mean, is it your view that it's too complex a question? I mean, I know that you support the setting up of them, but the minister who's in charge of the 71 Act, if you like, is saying it's really complex, and I'm not sure that I agree with that.
Well, I mentioned travelling from Edinburgh, I also mentioned travelling from Bearsden, so that's two places I've lived, so there we go. No, I think, I mean, they're always possible to, clever people can find reasons if they oppose something. And I don't think it's as, or I think whatever kind of challenges there are to implementation with the police working with the Crown Office, they will come up with a working solution. And, you know, you can imagine that if there was a zone where, people were not going to be searched and detained for possession, you know, you could imagine, oh, well, will drug dealers then move in and start dealing drugs in that area? Well, if that was happening, it would get picked up very quickly and the police would intervene. So, you know, it's not a free for all and an encouragement to drug dealers. So I think whatever practical objections or challenges there are, that those are entirely entirely able to overcome those. And the point is that doing so will save lives. That's the thing. It might reduce the number of people being arrested, but if it saves lives, then I think that's a win-win on both counts.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pauline. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs, followed by Eleanor Whittam. Over to you, Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Strang. Thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted to touch upon a few issues with regards to Community Pharmacy Scotland's role in the public health crisis, and you specifically highlighted naloxone in your opening statement. And I wanted to ask, in terms of some of the work which was meant to take place around access to single records for individuals, why that hasn't happened?
Right, that I need to say that that's too detailed a question for my level of knowledge at the moment, but I'm very happy to get an answer from the task force for you. I don't know the answer to that specific question, but I know that one of the things that the task force has commented on is the role of pharmacy and whether there should be a relaxing of some of the restrictions that are on some medications so that they can be more easily. And I mean, I think the whole thing about naloxone now being given into the hands of families of users, and I know that the nasal application is seen as more user-friendly than a needle and injection. But I mean, that's a sea change in the last 5 years of having relevant medication close to where it's needed.
And that's helpful, and that detail I'll maybe take up with the Minister in our next session, because I think it's important that the naloxone programme, which all of us support on this call, actually hasn't gone where we wanted it to. And part of the work, and I think frustration around the task force, has been that some of the key recommendations which were accepted don't seem to have happened. So I understand, fully understand you're new to this role, but I wondered, in terms of the discussions with Community Pharmacy, why you think that hasn't taken place?
So absolutely want to hear from Community Pharmacy, because I think they have a key role to play. And as I said in an earlier answer, I'm one of the tasks that I have or have asked for is an update on these 100 plus recommendations and what exactly has happened. At the last meeting and my first meeting of the task force, we had a presentation from the police, supported by an evaluation by an academic of the naloxone pilot. There was a pilot last year at three different sites where police officers were trained and carrying naloxone. And I think the results of that evaluation are due to be published soon, but I know that over 50 uses were made of naloxone. And so I think there was a sense that 56 lives potentially had been saved. So I think the overwhelming result from that pilot will be that it was successful, and there'll be a further rollout across Scotland of that.
That's helpful, and any information you could provide us with details of what that looks like would be very, very helpful. I want to move on to the role, and you touched upon this as well in your opening statement, with regards to addressing stigma and trauma-informed services, and specifically with regards to local government. There are concerns over budgetary pressures and where actually the recommendations of the task force and the work of local authorities in trying to turn around this public health crisis hasn't been necessarily taking place. Now, I fully accept the pandemic pressures which we've seen, but why do you think that has been, and are you concerned, given the cuts we're seeing to local council budgets, that the issues we need to see addressed by local authorities, housing being one of the key issues often, won't necessarily take place? And how will the task force try to recommend that that is given the priority it so willingly needs?
So you asked about stigma, and what we found is that stigma prevents people from coming forward for services, and even some very disappointing stories of the way they've been treated when they do go to services, that there's still quite a punitive view that this is a choice that you made. In a way, unlike other illnesses where people are treated with compassion and sympathy, often people are blamed, it's your fault, they're not trusted, they think you'll be dishonest, and there are more deserving cases. And it reminds me a bit of our attitude to mental health problems as well. I, as you know, chaired an inquiry into mental health services at Tayside, and it was interesting how often we heard from people who were in mental health services, and there's an overlap with substance misuse services, who felt that they weren't taken seriously, that somehow they were attention seeking, they weren't deserving patients, whereas if someone has a heart attack or has a broken leg, that they're a deserving patient. So I think stigma is important and is a barrier to tackling the issue. But I'd be interested that you mentioned housing, because that was, homelessness, I said, was a factor. I don't know whether it's a cause or a correlation, but anyway, it's a factor for, well, people both with mental health and substance abuse issues. And I think the lesson for this is that we cannot treat all these problems as a single issue. So, a council will have a housing policy, and a health board will have a mental health policy. And somewhere you'll find a substance use policy, and you'll have a trauma informed policy. But these won't work, these won't deliver. So that's why we need to be looking at the whole person and see, well, have they got a housing issue? Can they get into employment? Where are their support mechanisms? Your question about what more could be done, well, is not over 1,300 deaths a year enough motivation to free up some budgets? So I understand your question, and how we organise government, local government, is that we give money for housing, we give money for health, we give money for education. But the challenge for people leading and making decisions on those issues is about this person. What do they need, and need to make sure that is joined? I suppose my experience of that was from people coming out of prison. Often they will have needs for medication, for accommodation, for benefits, and we require them to be in three different places on the day of liberation. So, we need to get much better at joining up support for individuals that cuts across these traditional funding mechanisms.
Thank you. And finally, just before I hand back to you, convener.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to jump in. I've been very reluctant to do that, but I wonder if we can come back to you, Miles, if there is time at the end. I'm just keen to keep to time so that everybody can come in. Thank you. I'm now going to bring in Eleanor Whittam, followed by Gillian Mackay. Over to you, Eleanor.
Thank you very much, convener, and welcome to yourself, David, and your role. So we do know that there are strong links between poverty, deprivation, inequalities and problem drug use. And indeed, in Scotland, we can trace this back to economic policies from the 1980s. And at this point in time, we're seeing that it's people who grew up in those in this period, in their late 40s and early 50s, and my cohort, my age group, living in deprived areas, who have the highest risk of drugs deaths. So how crucial do you think the Scottish Government's anti-poverty work is in tackling the drugs deaths crisis? And do you recognise the need to work right across policy areas and government departments, local authorities and the third sectors? You've already touched a bit on that, but just to gather your thoughts in that area, thank you.
Yes, I agree with the question that you're asking, and you're right about that sort of middle-aged men are feature highly in the drug statistics. But also, I have to say that the number of young people dying drug-related deaths is increasing. There were 78 in the year of the last figure. So it certainly is that cohort that you're relating to, but it's also young people as well. And I think for me, the longer-term solution, the focus on prevention, is absolutely tackling those issues you talked about in terms of anti-poverty, reducing inequality, providing more opportunities, providing support for people who are traumatised, and brain injury is another feature. The young men in Pullman have five times the level of brain injuries than others in the population. So there are a number of factors which absolutely we need to address in a joined-up way for long-term prevention of drug problems. But I'm also applying it to the treatment and care of people who are at risk of dying through drugs. So a much more immediate short-term issue is that services also need to be joined up. So tackling poverty won't save someone's life tomorrow, but our services absolutely need to be joined up. So we need to join up housing and benefits and welfare and care and so on, so that people get the support that they need. So the answer to your question is both in the short term to save lives, but also if we're going to make a major impact in the longer term on prevention, then we need to be joined up right from the beginning of someone's life.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now, yeah.
Thank you very much for that answer. I want to actually revisit something that my colleague Miles Briggs has just brought up, and that's about stigma. So we know that stigma is a huge driving force that drives people away from services. Having previously worked for Women's Aid, supporting women fleeing domestic abuse, and many facing addiction issues born out of the issue of self-medication, the stigma and fear that they had with regards to losing custody of their children, not only due to the abuser's actions, but also due to, you know, bringing their addiction to light, letting it be known that they had the addiction, that fear was palpable. So how can we address stigma and the harm that it does cause? True public health approach to me surely must not seek to re-traumatise nor stigmatise. And if we think as well, people who are perhaps stopped for simple possession, who then maybe find themselves incarcerated for a period of time, etc. Again, a true public health approach actually should seek a different path. Is that what the Drugs Death Task Force actually believes as well?
Yeah. So I spent 5 years as Chief Inspector of Prisons for Scotland, and our prisons are full of people who have addiction problems and poor mental health. And we have one of the highest rates of imprisonment in Europe. Again, I would say it's not working. So going down a crime and prosecution and incarceration model is not reducing the drug deaths and the drug problems that we have. And I was hearing from someone recently who had this was in his history when he was using drugs and wanted some help. I went to his GP and said, "This is getting too much. I want some help." And the first question the GP asked him was, "Do you have children?" Now, of course, we should be concerned about children, and child protection is hugely important. But that communicated to him that the stigma that's associated with that. And so that was an immediate barrier to someone coming forward for help. Now, you know, I entirely understand that is a factor that needs to be taken into account, but not as the first question when someone walks through the door to ask for help.
Thank you. And finally, from myself, what are your views on a community justice approach, a smart justice approach? Do you see this as being soft touch justice, or do you see this being a crucial part in how we tackle this crisis we're facing?
Well, in 2007-2008, I was a member of the Scottish Prisons Commission that produced the report Scotland's Choice, which recommended the abolition of short sentences. So I have been entirely consistent over more than a decade in arguing that means you'd be much smarter, and that particularly short-term imprisonment in most cases does more harm than good, and we need to be much more creative about how we respond to offending behaviour and harm. I'm not saying we should do nothing, so it's not about being soft. And community sentences have potential to be much tougher than an easy stretch in prison for people who are in and out of jail the whole time. It's not a deterrent, obviously. Self-evidently not a deterrent. And similarly, I know that on the diversion from prosecution, there's evidence that that is much more likely to lead to someone getting the support and help that they need rather than being prosecuted, appearing before the sheriff and being sentenced. And I mean, I have to say that the police and the Crown Office have been very supportive of that, and that's part of the work that the task force is doing.
Right, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Elena. I'm going to hand on to Gillian Mackay, and then I'll bring in Sue Webber. And if I can just ask for questions and answers to be as succinct as you can make them. Over to you, Gillian.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr Strang. It's clear from the Joint Committee evidence session with Kit Malthouse MP yesterday that the Scottish and UK governments take a very different view with regards to the causes of drug use and how it should be addressed. What impact will this have, in your opinion, on the two governments working together on drug-related deaths, and what, if any, changes need to be made to improve partnership working?
So I don't know the answer to your question as to what impact it will have on governments working together. I would hope that on as serious an issue as this, that there could be perhaps behind the scenes negotiation to get satisfactory solution. I mean, we are the Scottish Drug Task Force, and our remit is to try and change attitudes and actions in Scotland. I don't think our remit extends to persuading London to change what they're doing. So, I mean, I understand entirely your question, and I heard Mr. Malthouse's evidence yesterday, and I just think that the emphasis on heavier policing as being a route to tackling our public health crisis isn't the right way forward. We've tried that for 50 years, and this is where we are. So I would hope that there can be sensible negotiations between both places, and that I know that we're exploring what can be done in Scotland under the current legal framework, and you know, people are being as creative and constructive as they can be. So I'm not insisting that the UK government changes its policies or what happens in England and Wales, but if something could be negotiated that makes what we're advocating more likely in Scotland, that would be very helpful.
Convener, Mr Strang managed to tempt my supplementary question, which was going to be about do we need a change of policy from the government to make things easier. So I think I'll hand back to you just now.
Thanks very much indeed. I thought you would have still tried to get another question in there, Gillian. I'll now bring in Sue Webber, followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Over to you, Sue.
Thanks, Convener. Earlier on, colleagues have spoken at length about the need for radical interventions and learning from elsewhere. But I'm really concerned with that, and I think we should be looking far closer to home and what is working well in Scotland right now to save lives. And my colleague Miles Briggs mentioned naloxone, and I have representations from the Royal Pharmaceutical Society this week around the current lack of consistency in terms of the naloxone and a lot of the issues. Should we not be looking at accelerating and embedding services that are doing well and saving lives now in Scotland that are not provided across the country? Would you not see that as a priority?
Absolutely, I see that as a priority, and I've mentioned a pilot of naloxone carriage by the police that we considered at the task force, and I know that we will be making recommendations about wider rollout of naloxone, and that's part of our discussions with community pharmacy. I don't think it's a choice. I don't think it's, you know, either we look to other cities internationally and do what they're doing, or, you know, implement the good things that we know work in Scotland. We have to do both. And I mean, there are lots of good things that are happening in Scotland. Thinking about some of the recovery network, the peer mentoring, the navigators work, the Pathfinder up in Inverness. And I think there's a lot of work going on in family support. Often these are not kind of officially run by government authorities, but actually support networks and local initiatives that provide support. And one of the important things I think you've raised is the inconsistency of service across Scotland. And I don't know if this is a feature of having however many geographic health boards it is, or 32 local authorities, but depending how you look at it, I mean, if you like local flexibility, then you're in favour of that sort of variance because it can match the local need. But you can also then describe that as a postcode lottery. And so why in one local authority can you get this disposal from court or this support certain network and somewhere else you can't? So it's not a straightforward question to answer as to whether you want absolute consistency across Scotland or whether we should allow flexibility. I suppose I want to ride both horses and say that we should, there should be consistent services for what people need, but I recognise that, you know, service requirements in Glasgow will be different from those in Shetland.
Yes, indeed, and I suppose it's that taking that short-term approach and trying to replicate and take on what's working well to address short-term crisis that we've got. But I'm also glad that you alluded to some of the services that are provided by the non-government agencies. The third sector is key.
Yeah.
And so I was wondering if you could maybe comment on how we might be able to help those third sector organisations who are carrying much of the burden and have done so throughout the pandemic as well, in terms of financing and giving them the longevity and the security of funding, what might happen around that angle?
Well, I mean, one of the things I think we should be doing is listening to them. And I mean, I know that they've been represented on the task force, and we've got some subgroups that the sector are working on. And part of our early programme as chair and vice chair of the task force, Fiona McQueen and I are visiting some third sector projects, really just to learn more and to hear what they have to say. And I think really I'd extend that more widely in terms of developing drug policy. We should be listening to people who have lived this and know what it's about, listen to their families. And in fact, the task force has three people who are representative of groups that have experience of supporting someone with a drug problem or have themselves. So I agree with you that we should be hearing their voice, and we need to support the third sector because they have an important part to play.
Kavina, can I get another question? Is that okay?
Very quickly, Sue, if you don't mind.
Of course, I'm a bit cookie. So, Mr. Strang, it's a bit different subject. I'm talking around the issue we've got right now. Is the task force specifically looking at the role of cocaine in the drug-related deaths? And do you get a sense that the treatment options for cocaine and our Scottish services are sufficiently skilled in addressing these issues that are coming to be much more prevalent and important in these drug-related deaths?
What I'd like to do is to respond to you on that in more detail, because I think that cocaine is not appearing highly in the toxicology for drug deaths, but I don't want to just give a quick answer to that. So I'll make sure that you get a proper answer on that issue about cocaine and treatment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Strang.
Thank you very much, Sue. I'm going to quickly move on to Faisal Chowdhury, and if we've got some time, I can open the session up to a couple of supplementaries before we finish. So, Faisal, over to you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, David. Nice to see you in your new role.
Thank you.
I've only got one question for you. The national record of for Scotland homeless death publication for 2020 showed that over half were drug related. There were 151 homeless drug related deaths, up from 68 in 2017. In 2020, homeless drugs related deaths accounted for 10% of all drug related deaths reported in the NRS 2020 annual report. Can you confirm what action has been taken to reduce homeless drug related deaths and ensure people who are homeless and suffer from drug related harms can access key support service, including drug treatment service? What is being done to reach out to this population?
Mr. Strang, before you come in, I'm just not completely sure that question relates completely to the work of the task force. It's a very legitimate question, but it is a much wider question in my view. So just to highlight to members about making sure questions remain on track. Thank you.
Okay, but I'd like to respond to it because it has a link with the drugs, and I suppose your question is illustrating my point about we can't deal with these with single issues, because people who are living, well, I mean, homelessness is wider definition than just rough sleeping, but people who have a housing need, and you're talking about people also with substance misuse treatment needs, often will have mental health needs. And what we need to do is to make sure that we join up those services so that one person has the support they need. They don't need to go to three offices at three different times for appointments that they probably won't keep. So, I mean, I think there are a lot of initiatives, things like street work and other people who are doing, who are providing support to people who are rough sleeping. And I know in Edinburgh there's a GP access point that's supporting people who are homeless. And I just think you raise an important issue that we do support the wider needs. They have needs for food. And accommodation needs as well. So I support the thrust of your question that these services need to be joined up and provide a whole person approach to supporting them. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. We've got a little bit of time in hand. So Miles Briggs, I'm happy to bring you back in. I did cut you off a little bit earlier on. So if you'd like to come back in,
sure. That's great. Thank you very much, Convener. I appreciate that. I was taken with what you said earlier, Mr. Strang, with regards to your work around mental health support in Dundee and the inquiry which you undertook there. And I wanted to ask specifically whether or not you would support a legal right to rehabilitation for people in Scotland around this issue, and whether or not that's a piece of work which the task force will start to look at, because I think it's very important, as you highlighted, that we make sure that people have the right to access these services and that people can actually take these decisions for themselves and drive their treatment. So I just wondered what your view was on that.
I think the central thrust of what you're saying is that I would agree that people should be consulted and have some sort of a choice in how they're treated, and I mean that's the way that health services have moved, that people, rather than you know, the doctor always knowing what best, she will now ask you what is your views on this, these are the options, and the decision making about someone's care I think tends to be much more of a joint the decision rather than the doctor simply saying, well, this is what you need and you take these tablets. And so I think the same should be applying for people who have health needs as a result of addictions, that they should be involved, engaged, perhaps with families as well, if that's appropriate. Of course, everyone should get appropriate treatment. I mean, that goes without saying. I mean, isn't that a basic human right, or maybe not the Human Rights Act, but certainly in Scotland, that people have a right to receive the treatment that they need, and that they should be consulted on that, and they should be treated with respect and with dignity and be listened to. Now, I would say that from my experience, speaking to people who've accessed mental health services and people who access drug services, they don't feel that they're respected and listened to. They don't think that their voice is heard. And you know, I've heard complaints of people being over-medicated and they want a different route, but that was all that was offered. So I do think that we have a way to go yet on treating people with dignity, respect, and engaging with them in discussing what their treatment needs are and to support them in delivering those.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to bring Eleanor Whittam back in for a follow-up question. Over to you, Eleanor.
Thanks very much, Convener. And it's just a brief question surrounding safer consumption facilities. Now, we did hear from Minister Kit Malthouse and that the UK government are still not convinced on their public health use. Now, what's your feeling around about that? Because in my experience, that is the gateway to actually accessing services for people who are maybe afraid to come forward and to, you know, to reach out in another way, are going to be able to be signposted in a setting where they're actually going to be looked after and kept safe. And hopefully kept alive if something terrible does happen. So it's just to gather your thoughts on that as a public health safety measure in terms of the whole basket of measures that we're going to be needing.
The evidence is that once people are in services, they're less likely to die. So we should be doing all we can to engage people in services. And I don't know enough about the actual workings of safer consumption facilities, but if those are places that I mean, clearly for the point of view of safer injecting and so on, that's a health benefit. But actually, if it also encourages people, enables them to be referred to services and be supported, then that's possible. I think of two other settings where things have changed in recent years. One is within the criminal justice system, where someone is detained at a police station. Often there will be, if there's a navigator scheme or an arrest referral scheme, if people have alcohol or drug addiction problems that they want support for, that can often be a trigger point. Similarly, people going to prison, that often again can be a time when, you know, if they've ignored what treatment they needed beforehand, that can open up a door. Or in hospitals, or if someone goes into hospital with, not because of their drug use, but for some other reason, then again, that can be a point of contact. So it's any point of contact with any service should be an avenue for someone who has problematic drug use to get into treatment and services. We should try and do that in all services.
Thanks very much. And I'll finally bring in Gillian Martin, and then we'll bring the session to a close. Gillian.
Thank you. I'll keep it very short. Yesterday, I asked Minister Kit Malthouse about his response to one of your recommendations about consumption facilities. And in the response, he said they might give the impression that they condone illegal drug use and that these facilities might become magnets for drug dealers, or even encourage people to take drugs. And I just want to know your response to that kind of response from Kit Malthouse and the UK government on that.
Okay, I'll keep my answer brief. But for me, it reveals a mindset that drug use is about criminality. So it encourages, he's talking about encouraging crime. And I think The argument for them is about tackling Scotland's public health crisis. So people who are addicted are unwell and they need medical care and support and treatment. And that's nothing to do with encouraging crime.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to bring the session to a close, and I'm just wanting to pick up, David, one point that you raised in relation to the implementation of the task force recommendations, and that you would be looking for an update on those. And I just wondered if it would be possible for those that update to be shared with the committee. We'd be really interested to know, or the committees, we'd be very interested to know a little bit about that. So if that would be possible, that would be appreciated. So in the meantime, many thanks for attending. It's been an interesting session, and obviously if members have additional matters that they'd like to follow up on, then we will do that in writing with you. So many thanks again. So we'll take a short suspension now before we hear from our next witness, and we'll reconvene at 11:15. Thank you. Welcome back again, members. I now welcome to the meeting Angela Constance, Minister for Drugs Policy, Sir Maurice Fraser, Head of Delivery and Support Unit of the Drugs Policy Division, and Henry Akers, Team Lead at the Drug Deaths Task Force Support Team of the Scottish Government. I thank the Minister for her written evidence and invite her to make some brief opening remarks. Minister, you have around about 3 minutes.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. I'm very grateful to all three parliamentary committees for coming together and joining up and working across portfolios, and for the opportunity to update committees on the actions that we are taking to implement the recommendations of the Drugs Death Task Force. I would like to start by saying that every life lost to a drug-related death is unacceptable, and I once again offer my condolences to those who have lost a loved one, and give my continued commitment to work across government, across Parliament and beyond to save and improve lives. I do want to once again take the opportunity to put on record my gratitude to the task force for their work to date. Their focus on evidence-based recommendations has helped to inform a response to this public health emergency. I would emphasise that the work of the task force sits within the context of a wider national mission, and we will consider its recommendations in line with those of our other expert groups too. The task force has supported a wide range of innovative tests of change. These projects undoubtedly have had a positive impact in their localities where they have operated, and the focus now is on learning from those projects, rapidly expanding and rolling out what we know will make a difference. I very much believe in evidence-based policy making, and I am committed to following the evidence as it emerges. I've taken on board all of the task force's recommendations to date, and I'm working to take them forward. The MAP standards are a prime example of that. The standards set out what people should expect and can demand of services, and implementing them across Scotland will give people access, choice and support through services. Through partnership with the task force, naloxone is now more widely available with distribution to the police and Scottish Ambulance Service, as well as expanded family and peer-to-peer distribution. Since the start of the Police Scotland Test of Change, 53 lives have been saved by police officers. The task force recommendations on stigma are also crucial. As we know, stigma is a barrier to access and support. And following these recommendations in December 2021, we launched a national campaign to tackle the stigma associated with substance use, highlighting that drug and alcohol problems are a health condition and those struggling with them should receive support, not judgment. Many of these changes that are needed have been talked about for decades but not delivered, and ultimately it is the impact of implementing the task force recommendations as part of the national mission that really matters. And that's why I'm acting quickly to accelerate delivery, and why I've asked the task force to provide their final recommendations by July this year. I do recognise that this presents an additional challenge, but I am confident that with the experience of David Strang and Fiona McQueen that they bring to the task force, that this ambitious goal is achievable. So thank you, conveners. I look forward to discussing implementation to date, the next steps with committee members, and I know that we can work together to tackle this public health emergency.
Thank you very much, Minister. So we'll now, as usual, move on to some questions, and I'd like to kick things off with a sort of general question, if I may. Obviously, there's been ongoing focus and scrutiny of the work of the task force and the wider work of the national mission, as you outlined, and delivery of the task force recommendations. And there's been some focus within that around the timescales, which you spoke about just towards the end of your statement. So, I'd like to ask, within that, are you satisfied that the task force is on course to complete its work within the timescales set, or if the may need to be reviewed, or perhaps they should be reviewed at any point down the line.
So this is something that I have discussed with the new leadership of the task force and the task force membership more broadly. I am confident that the task force will produce its vital recommendations by the summer. Obviously, the government is actively supporting the task force in their work. There is a team of civil servants who support the task force with secretariat tasks, etc. It has always been the case that we will need to look after the legacy of the task force work. There are some tests of change that won't be complete, but they wouldn't have been complete by the end of this year, the original timescale for the recommendations by the task force. Arrangements will have to be made. We will make those arrangements in consultation with the task force and the other to ensure that we continue to learn from the evidence as it emerges. I'm very clear I am committed to evidence-based policy, but I'm also clear that we can't wait on evidence being complete, because evidence is never complete. So we have to take what we know, implement it, and be prepared to adapt and change as we move forward.
Thank you very much, Minister. Just a quick follow-up question, if I may, on that point of evidence, and you spoke earlier on about following the evidence and the importance of that. Earlier on in our session with David Strang, we spoke about, and I think it was in response to a question Sue Webber asked, it was about looking at that wider context, perhaps international context, but also looking closer home, and certainly Mr. Strang felt that we should be doing both. Would that be your view as well?
Absolutely. International evidence is crucially important because there are other countries, many of them around the world, that have a far lower drug death rate than Scotland. So we absolutely should be looking at the very best of practice within Scotland, across the UK, but also internationally. So we do have a lot to learn. And you know, I make no bones about that.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm just going to move straight on and open up questions, if I may, and I'm going to bring in Paul O'Kane to begin with, followed by Russell Finlay. So over to you, Paul.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the minister. I think I'll kind of follow up in terms of a theme that I spoke when I questioned Mr. Strang, and it really is, I suppose, the role and the purpose of the task force. I think it's fair to say there has been criticism that the task force, you know, initially regards itself as advisory only. I think Mr. Strang kind of reiterated some of that position, but acknowledged the fact that there will have to be a mechanism for the task force to review work and to come back. So I suppose to ask the minister, does she think that that criticism is fair? And what further does she think needs to be done in terms of being able to drive forward the task force recommendations into action?
So I do very much concur with the view that it is government and institutions in this country that have to implement changes. It is imperative as part of our democracy that we are guided by Parliament, scrutinised by Parliament and parliamentary committees. But notwithstanding that, there is also a role for external organisations and experts in various fields, in particular, you know, the lived and living experience community, as well as, you know, academics and people who are providing services on the ground. I suppose in terms of the task force, yes, its remit did change. When I came into this post, the task force had been in operation for 18 months when I became minister responsible for drugs policy. And at that time, I was very clear about, I suppose, two things that were missing or that were needed corrected. One was that drugs policy should not be seen in isolation and that it absolutely had to be connected with every other government portfolio. Drug policy needs to be, you know, joined at the hip, you know, with justice, housing, homelessness, mental health, primary care, education, prevention, poverty and inequality. And that is a far bigger job than that of the task force. And if there was, and I'm aware from my very early engagement with some stakeholders and various party spokespersons and MSPs, there was concern about, you know, how the government was performing in relation to tackling drug deaths, and there were concerns in and around the task force. And my view was that the government had outsourced its responsibilities, and that I, you know, would not be doing that. I wanted to support the evidence-led work of the task force, but that actually any criticism of the task force should rest rightly with the government and not the task force, which is comprised of individuals, citizens who were given of their time and their talents to work with the government. So yes, there was that refocusing of the role and remit of the task force.
Thank the Minister, Convener, for that response. And I think we are all keen to ensure that parliamentary scrutiny is at the heart of this. And you may have heard my follow-up in terms of ensuring that committees of this parliament particularly have a laser focus, if you like, on these issues. And I think clearly what you're saying there is that as Minister, you are keen to engage in that scrutiny and not essentially, I think outsource was the word you used in terms of the national mission. Obviously, I've said this in chamber as well around ensuring that we have regular opportunity around scrutiny. So I don't know if the Minister can maybe outline, you know, how would she see a committee like this joint committee operating going forward? Is this something that she would welcome in terms of the scrutiny of the work of the task force and indeed the overall work of the national mission going forward?
It is, of course, not for a government minister to be in any way indicating to committees how they should proceed with their business. What I will say is that I very much embrace scrutiny. While it is not always comfortable, it is absolutely necessary, and I can assure you it always leads to better outcomes. I do welcome this joined-up approach taken by the three parliamentary committees involved today, because actually it's reflective of the work that we are embarking upon in government to ensure, as I say, that drugs policy is joined at the hip with other crucial public policy and not seen in isolation. And it's also what we're trying to get our services to do in communities as well, is to have that joined up approach. So I very much welcome this. There is a role for parliamentary scrutiny of the government, of the Drugs Deaths Task Force, the Residential Rehabilitation Group, how we implement MAT standards, the National Implementation Group, and of course people will be really interested, I am sure, on the new National Collaborative as well. So, you know, the national mission is of course bigger than any one single group. There's a lot to scrutinise and there's a lot to engage in.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Paul. I'll move on and I'll bring in Russell Finlay, followed by Gillian Mackay. Russell.
Hello, Minister. Yesterday, Kit Malthouse spoke passionately about the need to support those with drug problems, but also for the vital role of criminal justice system. He spoke about, for example, a ring of steel being put around the community of Blackpool as part of Project Adder. And we know that every single day, Police Scotland and the National Crime Agency work hard to target the organised crime gangs that make so much money from killing people in Scotland with their products. I suppose the question is, do you agree that it's not one or the other? And can you give a commitment to Scottish communities that they will enjoy robust policing and targeting those who deal in drugs?
I'm grateful to Mr. Finlay for that question, because it does highlight the important role that police have in terms of upholding the law. He may be aware that there is a serious organised crime task force, and much of what he describes is very firmly in the remit of the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, and nobody would demur from the importance of trying to interrupt the supply of drugs, or indeed you know, bring those who pose the greatest risks to individuals and to our communities to justice. I suppose what I would say from my perspective to Mr. Finlay is, again, looking at the evidence that, again, from across the world, is that we know that more punitive approaches, and that where a criminal justice system is solely focused on enforcement, that can actually add additional harms and add to barriers to treatment. And I don't know if he's aware of the work of the Conservative Drug Policy Reform Group, which produced some interesting findings recently, and it spoke about how it's important that different policies don't work against each other, and therefore it's important in terms of policing and how our criminal justice system operates, that doesn't become, you know, a barrier to people accessing treatment, and that it doesn't add to the harms that people are already experiencing. And I also think, you know, there is more work to do in terms of engaging communities with what will make them safer at the end of the day, and treatment, and ensuring people have access to better and quicker treatment is a huge part of that also, and that a public health approach, and again all the evidence would point to this, is better for smarter justice in our community, but also in terms of making our communities and individuals safer as well.
Thank you. Many prisoners are unable to break their addiction due to the high levels of drugs in prisons, and indeed some prisoners go into prison without a drug problem and leave with one. Do you think we can ever get close to eradicating drugs in prisons, and what perhaps immediate steps can be taken to do something about it?
So, in terms of things like RapiScan scanners, Mr. Finlay, I'm sure, will have discussed these matters in detail with the Justice Secretary, and you know that the safety and well-being of prison staff and prisoners is of, you know, utmost importance. What I would say, and it's reflective of what we know about the wider community, is that we know that we can't arrest our way out of a drugs death crisis, and therefore it has to be about addressing the root causes of people's substance use. It has to be about that bigger, broader agenda, you know, around homelessness and poverty. But it's also about ensuring that people have access to treatment, and treatment that is right for them. And that access to treatment and support is crucial within our prisons as well, in terms of the healthcare. There is a very important survey of prisoners' health and social care needs that will be complete by spring, if I recall that correctly. There is really important work going on led by the recovery community within our prisons. I certainly visited a number of recovery cafes. So I suppose what I'm saying is that we need to be focused on addressing the needs of individuals, and there are also broader issues about overcrowding in prison, and that our prison population, I think most commentators would be of the view, is too large.
Yeah. Thank you. Have I got time just to quickly follow up on that? Or?
Yeah. On you go.
Thank you. So last September, Cabinet Secretary for Justice told the Criminal Justice Committee that, I'll just quote, prisoner governors in England and Wales have stated that it's not possible to have a drug-free prison. I would like to test that to see what extent it can be achieved. I mean,
Is that realistic?
Well, I'm not going to contradict the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, where I will routinely provide a challenge to my colleagues is what more can we do to ensure that people have access to treatment and support to address their use of substances. And I'm very clear that as we are working to implementing the medication-assisted treatment standards, for example, that those also have to apply in prisons as well. So I think a key part, it's not the only part, but a fundamental part of improving lives and saving lives is ensuring that our prison population get better access to healthcare, and that includes drug treatment as well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Russell. I'm now going to hand over to Gillian Kai, and then I'll bring in Eleanor Whittam. So, Gillian, over to you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. About the UK government's action on consumption rooms, is the Minister confident that there is still a way forward for Scotland to launch a pilot?
So, yes, I am. Sorry, Ms. Mackay, I don't think I caught all the question there, but I'm sure it's about our work around safer drug consumption rooms and something about Mr. Malthouse's evidence yesterday. So it's a matter of public record that work is going on with reference to a pilot for a safer drug consumption facility in Glasgow. A proposition has been brought forward by the Health and Social Care Partnership in Glasgow for that pilot. And there is very extensive work going on between Crown Office, police, ourselves in terms of Drug Policy Division, and our local partners in Glasgow. And I do note Mr. Malthouse and I come from a different position on this. I am very strongly of the view that there is no dispute in the evidence. The safer drug consumption facilities can save lives. I will, of course, reference committee to the evidence paper that the government produced not that long ago, and I'm sure it was shared with the Justice Committee at the time. I've also shared with committee an exchange of correspondence between myself and Mr. Malthouse. I think he sees more problems than I see. There are undoubtedly issues that need to be resolved, and that's what we are actively engaged with. There are three avenues to pursue drug consumption facilities. The UK government could, of course, introduce primary legislation, I suppose, in a way that Ireland did a number of years ago. It could, of course, devolve powers to Scotland and enable us to introduce legislation, or the third option is that we pursue what we can within our own powers to bring forward a proposition that is both clinically and legally safe for both those who use the service and who work in the service. So it is delicate work, it is detailed, and yes, it has its difficulties, but that work is progressing, and we are absolutely committed to doing everything we can, where possible within our powers, to implement evidence-based interventions that save lives.
Gillian, back to you. Do you want to come back in?
Thank you. Yes, just briefly, Convener, thank you. Kit Malthouse said in his evidence during the joint meeting yesterday that he did not recognise poverty as a driver of drug use, and that drugs and violence drive poverty. I'm deeply concerned about the apparent equating of drug use with violence and the UK government's belief that poverty does not drive drug use, and there's a clear conflict between the Scottish and UK government's understanding of the cause of drug use. What impact will this have on the UK and the Scottish government's ability to work together on the issue? And how will it impact efforts to tackle the stigma surrounding drug use?
So it's no secret that myself and Mr. Malthouse, but we will have different views on, in particular, harm reduction interventions. And we will have different views about the lens that drug use should be viewed through. I do very much recognise the role and relationship of poverty and other matters in relation to this. There's been a lot written and published about the impact of very concentrated levels of poverty and social deprivation. So there's an obligation, and this is where I would agree with Mr. Malthouse, there's a moral obligation to address poverty. But I would also say that as well as those bigger structural changes about our society, we do need to also be focused on the here and now. And that's very much related to the work that we're doing to invest in services and to reform services and to move matters forward as much as we can, as quickly as we can.
Thanks, convener.
Thank you very much, Gillian. I'm now going to bring in Eleanor Whittam, followed by Sue Webber. Eleanor.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to yourself, Minister. Following on from my colleague Gillian Mackay there, it has been argued that the high drug death rate in Scotland is partly a delayed health effect from the circumstances in the 1980s. How should current anti-poverty policies respond to this? And do we need to have more emphasis on whole community regeneration with a public health approach and wellbeing approaches right in the heart of our communities? And that's going to help reduce stigma and support everyone, including those experiencing problem drug use.
So convener, there's a lot in that question. I do think there needs to be a bit of care taken around the narrative of the 1980s. I always find talking about the 1980s somewhat triggering, but there is no doubt that that there was a scarring effect of the 1980s, and I suppose it's something that we need to bear in mind, as we did in response to the financial crash and the spike in youth employment. We knew the rise in youth unemployment has a scarring impact on people's life chances. It's why following a recession or indeed a pandemic, that we need to, as part of recovery, be very much focused on reducing the risk of those long-term impacts on our society and our communities. So the relationship between drug use and poverty is very clear. The annual report last year on the drug-related death statistics showed that you are 18 times more likely to die of a drug-related death if you are in our most deprived communities. And where I would always urge a bit of caution is sometimes people look at the structural issues in and around poverty, and that can mean that they can feel quite helpless. And we shouldn't feel powerless in the face of poverty. Poverty, after all, is man-made. So the work that we are doing around child poverty, for example, and our work in social security, there's members of the Social Justice Committee here. I'm not going to go through all of those things in detail. But if I can point to one example, and actually, and not just because I introduced it, the Fairer Scotland duty, which means that all public agencies, in terms of the allocation of the resources and those big strategic decisions, need to have at their heart the drive to reduce poverty. So I hope I've answered all Ms. Whittam's question. Oh yeah, but also the point about regeneration is really important, because while if you look at our child poverty delivery action plan, the focus on the evidence is on things like income and work and reducing the cost of living, but certainly the first child poverty action plan, which will be updated soon, and again that was work I was involved in, also looked at the impacts of drug use, particularly in families, but also about quality of life. So the role of community regeneration is really important because it is about resilience. It's often about community action, but also is about resilience of communities as well.
I think you're on mute, Eleanor. Yeah,
am I on mute? No. As a member of the Prevention Review Group, I understand the clear need to prevent homelessness from occurring in the first place. And I'm glad to see the public consultations underway on the prevention duties. Minister, like me, do you recognise the need for wider public bodies to have a duty to ask and to act when it comes to preventing homelessness, working across departments and sectors to support individuals and families? And how do you see this approach helping to reduce drugs deaths and the devastation that they cause?
So I have recently had some meetings with Ms Robeson about the strengthening the homelessness prevention duties. And I think there is something very simple, powerful and fundamental about this ask and act, because what it shouldn't be is that you ask somebody and then that you act by, you know, referring them on or, you know, and that will be appropriate at times. But in that whole philosophy of ask and act, it should also be about how you can act before you refer someone on as well. So it's and culturally important in terms of that sense of ownership and more collegiate working across the different workforces. And I think, and I'm looking very closely at this work that Ms Robeson's leading, because I think there's something very important that we could also learn from and perhaps implement in and around drugs policy is, you know, and it connects also with the MAT standards, but it's about how do we make people's rights real and reality.
Back to yourself, Convener.
Thank you very much, Eleanor. I'm going to bring in Sue Webber now, followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Sue, over to you.
Thank you, Audrey. I've got a couple of questions for the Minister. Since the introduction of the Recorded Police Warning Scheme, which effectively decriminalised Class B and C drugs, the number of admissions to psychiatric hospitals for cannabis users has increased by 74%. So, in light of this evidence, does the Minister still support the policy and its extension, which effectively decriminalised Class A drugs?
So, yes, Convener, I do continue to support the use of recorded police warnings, which were extended recently in relation to Class A drugs, which is heroin and opioids. And essentially, it's a discretion that police have. And again, it's based on, you know, that wealth of international evidence that our justice system, at every twist and turn, needs to be providing opportunities to divert people away from the criminal justice system into either, you know, diversionary activities or indeed treatment. And I know Ms Webber and I, we have a kind of fundamental disagreement around that. Where I think we have common ground is around the increase in hospital admissions around cannabis. While cannabis is rarely implicated in drug-related deaths, it features, as we've seen from various statistics, it features heavily in hospital admissions and psychiatric admissions, and that is often due to the kind of synthetic cannabinoids. So that relationship between cannabis use and mental health is a point, I think, which we would agree on. This increase in hospital admissions in relation to cannabis is across all ages, but there's also some concerns I have in and around young people. So young people have different patterns of drug use. We know that most young people and young people are increasingly moving away from risky behaviours, but for those young people who do use drugs, they're far less likely to be using opiates. It's more likely to be cannabis or maybe MDMA or cocaine. So we have work that's ongoing about ensuring that we can develop services that are more bespoke to young people, and that also feeds into the work that we are doing around the prevention material to reach young people, not just in schools, but young people in settings out with schools. But the reason we have a national mission, actually, it's to consider the harms and risks of all drugs and the best way to reduce those harms and risks. And that, I suppose, is very nub, is often about getting more people into the right treatment at the right time. My apologies for the length of that answer, Convener.
Thank you, Minister, for that reply. I suppose we've had a very productive few sessions with our joint committee, and I suppose my recollection of yesterday's with Mr. Malthouse might be a little bit different to others. I felt it was quite collegiate, and he was always extending and seeking to work collaboratively with yourself, Minister, and that's exactly. But I'm concerned that with some of the questions today and the focus that we've had in particular from the SNP members and the Green government, that the whole argument and positioning of the consumption rooms is just now there to stoke a grievance and create something that can be used to prevent us tackling and adopting new policies and tactics that we can do now to stop people from dying. Would you have a comment on that, Minister?
So, what I would say that it is often important that you work harder to engage with those that you disagree with. And it is, again, it's no secret that Mr. Malthouse and I have a different perspective in and around implementing a public health approach, and we have different perspectives around some harm reduction and interventions, safer drugs consumption facilities being just but one. But what I will say, in all fairness, I've had a number of discussions with him. There's been a number of meetings actually on a four nations basis, whether it's British Irish Council or the UK Drug Summit that I participate in and engage in. And we've had lots of correspondence. And yes, I'm a persistent corresponder to Mr. Malthouse. But my ethos is to engage him and his government on the evidence. And my correspondence to him on safer drug consumption facilities has always been about the evidence that these work. And what has been useful about our more recent correspondence, and I suppose Mr. Malthouse's appearance yesterday, is he's spoken more and in more detail about what his concerns are. And that gives me the opportunity to refute concerns around the evidence, because actually the evidence, in my view, is crystal clear. And again, I can point to evidence across the world, evidence produced by other experts, as well as our own evidence paper. He sees more obstacles to implementation than I do. But if there was a way for us to work together to overcome any obstacle, you know, I have an open door to that. So just my stress is that I seek to engage in the evidence and not the politics.
Thank you, Convener.
Then Faisal Chowdhury now, and then we'll move on to Gillian Martin. Faisal, over to you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. In November, the Scottish Government published survey result from residential rehabilitation providers in Scotland relating to pathway into, through and out of residential rehabilitation. One concern raised in the survey was that homelessness service had pressure to reduce figures, and that those who are homeless in residential treatment are still classed as homeless and may need to leave earlier than advised due to homelessness sector pressure to lower numbers. It's unclear from the survey if this is localized issue or if it is a wider problem. Has the Scottish Government investigated this concern in more details? And if so, what were the findings, and has any action been taken to address the concerns, given the potential adverse impact of those receiving care?
So I really appreciate that question, because there is a number of issues around residential rehabilitation. I am committed to taking a balanced approach to securing a whole system of care, and residential rehabilitation is an important part of that. It has historically been supported and funded less, and this government is now seeking to address that. And as part of the statement I made to Parliament, it would have been November last year, there was a whole suite of information that was published. And some of this information was published to actually shine a light on where things were not operating as they should be. But as part of that suite of information, it was also about the work going forward to improve access to funding and improve those pathways, and also ensure accountability with the government, but also accountability at a local level, so that people could see where the funding was going, and you know how many placements were being funded by you know ADPs area to area. I do know that the pandemic had an impact on some services. I'm not sure if I've picked Mr. Chowdhury up correctly. I'm not sure of any ongoing concerns, but the Residential Rehab Development Working Group continues to liaise very closely with residential rehab providers. And where there are issues to iron out, I'm very, you know, proactive about that, and that's why there is a housing support fund to ensure that people don't have to choose between maintaining their tenancy at home or going into residential rehab. And this was to mitigate around some issues around the rules, or how the rules of housing benefit were implicated. So I hope that answers Mr. Chowdhury's question. I hope I've picked it up all correct.
Yes, you did. Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you very much, Faisal. I'll hand over to Gillian Martin, and then I'll bring in Miles Briggs. Gillian.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the minister. It's around drug treatment for people who require it. First of all, I want to ask, you know, if we've got any indication or estimation of the number of people out there that might not be in treatment who probably could benefit from it. And also, what are we doing, and what's the Scottish Government doing with partners to improve and expand the capacity for a range of treatments? The Minister will know I have a particular interest in treatments for people who have caring responsibilities. And there has to be alternatives for people that fit in with those responsibilities.
So some of the work that we are actively engaged in just now is updating prevalence. So we need to update our understanding of the extent of and the prevalence of drug use in our society, so that there are some existing data, and I recently announced some funding again just before Christmas to update that. So we need to, you know, understand more about prevalence in Scotland, and the reason that's important, that's crucial information to introduce our treatment target. To answer Gillian's question very direct, it's we don't have enough of our people in treatment. You know, that would be a very fair critique. We don't have enough of our people in treatment, and we don't do enough to retain people in treatment, or indeed to follow them up if they fall out of treatment. Hence, you know, our investment in things such as non-fatal overdose pathways and outreach. So the new treatment target, will be, crucial, and the indicators that underlie that in terms of improving and scrutinising, the numbers of people that are in treatment. And as I say to Parliament before Christmas, we will bring forward and publish and announce that in spring this year. In terms of the issue about capacity, so much of our work around MAT standards on residential rehabilitation is about not just improving the ways in which we work, but is also about increasing capacity as well. And there's also an important point here about workforce capacity. So we're undertaking work right now in terms of mapping the shape and size of the workforce to identify gaps, to look more at training needs. There's an issue of stigma that's very pertinent to the workforce as well. Quite often, that the workforce can feel quite stigmatised too. And we will look at a recruitment campaign as well. And all of this has to be joined up with other big national workforce strategies, across government as well.
Thank you very much. I want to follow up on my family's, my wider family's point. I mean, a range of work's been done to support families who might have a member of their family who has problems with the drug use. Could you expand on some of the things that have been done there?
So absolutely, and we've tried to take a belt and braces approach with this. So, on the one hand, is part of our new funds that are available to stakeholders and third sector organisations, there is a very specific children and family fund, for services and third sector organisations to apply for direct funding from the Scottish Government. That's managed via the CORA Foundation, and those direct funding opportunities have been very popular. There is also we published before Christmas our whole family approach framework, and again that came with a funding package for ADPs as well. And again, because all the evidence at home and abroad, indicates that we need to be supporting families as a whole, but also as individuals as well, be it children or be it parents. And we know that for every one person who has a drug or alcohol problem, that there is an impact on 11 other people. So families are absolutely crucial to this. And supporting families and where possible, keeping families together is crucial. And that family involvement in an individual's treatment needs to be considered an appropriate option and choice for the individual as well. So that this is about, I suppose, services being and some do this very well, working with the family as a whole better, as well as serving the individual needs. There's obviously the announcement we made last year around our National Family Residential Service, which will support up to 20 families at any one time. And that's part of our work to keep the promise. Again, I won't go into detail unless pressed, but again, the work of the promise is highly germane to the work I'm doing. And we also need to have better standards of service for women as well, and more bespoke services for women too, because that has been a gap. And while it is mostly men who lose their lives, we are seeing the increase in women losing their lives is rising at a disproportionate rate.
Thank you very much. Hand back to the convener.
Thank you, Gillian. I'll now bring in Miles Briggs and then Pauline.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your officials as well. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to the Naloxone programme and Community Pharmacy Scotland, because we all support that. And in terms of where I think it could have made a difference, I've been frustrated to see where the work of the task force hasn't really taken that. So I wanted to ask you specifically two points. Why is it that the Naloxone is not included on the national supply line through Pharmacy First, for pharmacists to access it? And specifically, in terms of the recommendations from the task force, why has a single record for patients not been developed, given the public health emergency and given the potential improvement to outcomes that could deliver?
Okay, there's three aspects to this question, and let me deal with the devolved aspect first, because there is a reserved aspect. So the bit about single records needing to be addressed is well made. I have met with Community Pharmacy and also the Royal College of Pharmacists, and they rightly point out that with better linkage of records, they could be doing more. And that is something that my officials have raised with the Chief Pharmacist and Health Division. So I absolutely accept that point. The pharmacists are absolutely correct to raise it. I want to see a resolution to that, because I think there is much more that pharmacy and pharmacy services can bring to the table here. And this is where it also takes us to issues in and around naloxone being registered as a controlled drug, and this is where you know, our engagement with the UK government is important as well. So if naloxone was classified differently, and there are different options, so you know, it could be part of a pharmacy service in the way that you can have an individual consultation with a pharmacist over a range of medications. You could do that with naloxone, particularly the one that you know, the kit that involves a needle. But there's also an argument that the pharmacists make in terms of nasal naloxone, that actually, if that was reclassified, that could be, you know, just sold in the chemist in the same way that you buy, you know, decongestion. And I think, and that would require, you know, some changes at a UK level. I think that would really help in terms of widening that distribution and acceptance of naloxone. I suppose over and above that, I would actually say I think the task force has done really good work in this area. And in terms of the reach of naloxone, it is up to about 59%. And if you want a technical explanation about how that has worked out, I will probably hand you over to Maurice Fraser. But I think, you know, things like, you know, as a result of our naloxone campaign, you know, there's been 4,000 kits distributed. I think the work that Scottish families affected by alcohol and drugs in terms of that click and deliver service is first class. The work that the police are doing, Scottish Ambulance Service have given out 1,000 kits that they announced, and their work is also really relevant, not just in terms of distributing, you know, take home naloxone kits, but also, you know, connecting people to services. So I actually think task force has done good work in and around naloxone. I do think there's more to do, pharmacy. I also think there's more to do in terms of naloxone, which is now becoming available in prisons prior to release, but there's also much more we could do, I think, in terms of mental health services. You know, so there's areas of improvements, but I think your point about pharmacy is well made.
Okay, thank you for that. I think one of the things which would be really helpful is any update on timescales around this, because on my work when I was a member of the Health and Sport Committee, I think we understood this would be moved forward quite quickly, and especially the opportunity to have some sort of traffic light warning system for patients just doesn't seem to have materialised. So I hope that is genuinely going to become a priority and we see that move forward. I wanted to move on in terms of reviewing treatments available as well. I know I've been in correspondence with you on this for some time, but whether or not we're looking at potential other treatments available around NET and things like that, and genuinely for people to feel that they can take decisions around what's best for them and also their families at where they are potentially in their addictions, and where actually that can support their personal decision making and empowerment as well, and just where the government was on with some of that work stream as well.
So, convener, if Mr. Briggs wishes, in terms of his latter point, we are, you know, on track in and around developing our public health surveillance system. building on the kind of warning systems that exist. So this is kind of broader than a traffic light system or the distribution of naloxone. And that we're also waiting to hear the results of the UK-wide consultation on naloxone, but we'll certainly endeavour to keep Mr Briggs and of course the committees involved and informed as well. I think in terms of treatments, again, you know, treatments that are based in evidence are absolutely crucial and have to be a priority. Notwithstanding that, you know, if you take, you know, the NET, we have of course corresponded with Mr Briggs on this and pointed people in the direction of the kind of chief scientific officer in terms of, you know, how you pursue things like trials. But the point, I think the really fundamental point that Mr Briggs makes about informed choice is an absolutely core part of the medication-assisted treatment standards, because people, like all patients who are receiving a healthcare service, we come to an informed choice and we are supported in coming to that informed choice by, you know, clinicians practitioners. And, you know, people should be able to make informed choices around medication-assisted treatments, but also, you know, other types of treatments as well. And, of course, the whole purpose of MAT is making that connection between, I suppose, the options and possibilities around pharmaceutical interventions, but also psychosocial interventions as well. So I think the point he makes about us having a balanced approach and implementing what works, not just in terms of, you know, the evidence, but also what meets the needs of individuals is important.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks.
Over to you, Polly.
Thanks.
Pauline, can we hear you?
Sorry, it just cut out for a second.
Can you hear us?
Yeah, thank you very much. Good afternoon, Minister. Hope it goes without saying that I realise that the challenge is a huge one and that it's a very complex one. But I do have an interest in the overdose prevention safety issue, because I hosted Nanna Godfredsen, who is a street lawyer from Denmark, who's a pioneer to the whole policy in Denmark and has been influential in the debate here. So there's been quite a bit of exchange on this, and you probably heard the minister yesterday. I suppose my first question is, one of the things that came across, I think it's actually Gillian Martin's line of questioning, seemed to come across that he was concerned that it would send out the wrong message. So if we review the 1971 Act and include even the ability to pilot these in that Act, he was concerned it would send out the wrong message. I just wondered if you wanted to respond to that.
And can I just say, you know, I'm very aware of Ms McNeill's work in this area, and frequently meet stakeholders who talk about her work and the events that she's hosted in the past. It's just that in terms of the comments made by Mr Malthouse, that, you know, about, you know, some of these services such as safer drug consumption facilities giving out, you know, the wrong message or encouraging drug use, there is just no evidence of that. I mean, you do hear people verbalise that concern, but there's just no evidence. Whereas there is evidence to show that safer drug consumption facilities reduce overdose deaths, they save lives, that they reduce transmission of bloodborne viruses, that they reduce, you know, infection to wounds and improve wound care, and that they can also help reach people who inject drugs who might not otherwise, you know, engage with services or indeed be visible to services. And there's also, you know, and because much of this, and Ms McNeill is a Glasgow MSP, you know, much of the campaign and coalescing around safer drug consumption facilities came through. Actually, there is a community benefit to this as well, in terms of reducing, you know, drug-related litter and, you know, drug use in public places. So there's evidence that they work, and there's evidence about the benefits. This isn't. It's not a silver bullet. I mean, nothing ever is. But I just think in Scotland we need all of the options. And you know, I do have views about, you know, the Misuse of Drugs Act. But we want to have all of the options to help us address this national scandal, this national crisis.
Thank you. The Minister went on to say that he thought there were complex questions that needed to be answered if we legislated in this way. So I recognise that ideally a reform of the 1971 Act would be best positioned for other reasons as well. Mm. As you say, Minister, it's not a silver bullet. Nothing is. But the Lord Advocate is on record as saying that she will consider this question as to whether or not it might be in the public interest. I suppose my question is, I guess it will be complex for any Lord Advocate to make a decision about whether or not in the public interest you would not prosecute under the 71 Act in certain areas if it was a public health issue that prevented deaths. I suppose the question is twofold. One, do you think these complexities can be overcome? And if the Lord Advocate, who has yet to make a decision, it makes one in that vein, I suppose it would negate the immediate necessity to reform the 71 Act because it would have the same effect, or would it?
So there's a number of issues there, Convener, and I hope you give me a wee bit of latitude and answering all of that properly. So in terms of the Misuse of Drugs Act, I mean, you know, my view would be it's old, it's nearly as old as me, it is written for another time. A lot of the evidence that the task force gathered, you know, people feel that it's rooted in that drug use is all about personal failings and you know, the need for punishment. So I do think, you know, a root and branch review is needed. And because in my view, it impedes that public health approach. Other people might argue that actually it's completely contradictory to a public health approach, and you know, it impedes not just work around safe drug consumption facilities, but other, you know, harm reduction work, you know, as well. And there's, you know, some examples I can give with that if need be. But in terms of the Lord Advocate, so the Lord Advocate made a very, you know, clear statement to the Justice Committee last year, and saying, you know, that she would be prepared to reconsider what was in the public interest and to reconsider another application. But she also scoped out what needed to be addressed and considered. So she spoke about the need for evidence. Now, I think that's the most straightforward part. I think the evidence is clear. It's clear cut. But she also, you know, spoke of the need for detail and precision, and that all of the partners, you know, needed to be on board, and that included the police. So that is why, you know, we are working, you know, across all of these boundaries. There are issues and complexities. I'm not going to make any bones about that. I won't repeat the correspondence that I sent to Mr. Malthouse, or the correspondence, you know, he sent me. But I think you will see, you know, he and somebody as helpful has put on record what his concerns are. And I think, you know, many of them can be rebutted. But nonetheless, there are issues around how this is policed, you know, in and around the vicinity. It's also the need for us to be working through all of the potential scenarios with our partners. It's why, you know, we need to be looking in detail at the operating procedures, at staff training, the service user information about what is permitted and what isn't permitted. So this really is detailed, precise work, and there are difficulties around it. And while it would be easier if the UK government legislated or devolved powers, and I'll continue to pursue them on that on the basis of the evidence, but equally, and actually what I'm more invested in, is doing absolutely everything we can to find a solution, to find our own solutions with regards to this. And if the police are content and the Lord Advocate are content, well, you know, if we can get to that position, well, so be it.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much, Pauline. So we're almost at the end of our session. It's been a long but very informative morning. However, if I'd ask for members' forbearance and just perhaps ask one more very quick question, Minister, before you go, and that's on the National Collaborative. So obviously we are aware of the announcement recently regarding the National Collaborative. So I just really wanting to ask you to maybe just make a few points about the remit and the purpose of the collaborative and how it might work sort of alongside the task force, which also obviously has members with lived experience contributing to its work.
I'm really excited about the National Collaborative. I was committed to bringing this forward in part due to my experience in social security and the work we've done around lived experience there and experience panels, but also from my previous days in education where I've seen the benefits of the Early Years Collaborative. And I think it's absolutely crucial that there is a vehicle that is owned by the voices of experience, that it's theirs. And I'm delighted that Professor Miller, you know, Scotland's leading human rights expert, you know, has agreed to chair that, because I think he does come with an independence. You know, he is, you know, well placed to understand the impact of trauma, for example, and he has done previous work with survivors of in-care abuse, where he was able to, you know, bring forward a programme of work and really amplify those voices and voices that ensured that change happened. And I'm thinking in particular around the redress scheme. So I'm really confident about the National Collaborative going forward. Professor Miller is now engaged in a series of engagements, introductory meetings, you know, one-to-one meetings, you know, with the sector and, you know, people with lived and living experience, and he will work with them, and they'll bring forward, you know, a programme of work, you know, milestones and timescales. But this is a really important part of the national mission, because we need to ensure that those voices of experience are plugged into every aspect of that national mission. This is also about enabling those voices to inform and drive change, and also to be informed by a human rights approach.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that helpful update. And we very much look forward to hearing more about the progress of the collaborative. So that completes our evidence session this morning. I'd like to thank you very much indeed, ministers and your officials, for attending this morning. And of course, if members have any further questions, we'll follow those up in writing. So many thanks again. So that concludes the public part of this meeting, and we'll now move into private session and on to MS Teams. Thank you very much.